Good afternoon. So nice to be able to come here, and I hope it was good soup today, so a thank you to those who brought soup, and a welcome to all who are here today. We're just doing a few things that are a little different, and I hope you enjoy. For the last two hymns, I call it Finding the Sacred in the Secular. I don't think I've ever sung High Hopes, but when you stop and think about the words to High Hopes, you know, to think about that in terms of faith. And of course, Paul McCartney's Let It Be is quite appropriate. So today we are talking about finding grace in the midst of disappointment. Please stand as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. To you, O God, all hearts are open. To you, all desires known. We come to you confessing our sins. Forgive us in your mercy and remember us in your love. Show us your ways, teach us your paths, and lead us in justice and truth. For the sake of your goodness, in Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. By water and the Holy Spirit, God gives you a new birth, and through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God forgives you all your sins. The God of mercy and might strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life. Amen. Let us sing the Kyrie, Holy Spirit, Rain Down, as printed in your bulletins. Peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, the love of Christ that guards our hearts and minds, and the joy and consolation of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And
also with you. Let us pray. O God, rich in mercy, full of kindness, out of your great love, you raise us up from sin and death and make us alive together with Christ. Write your word upon our hearts and restore in us the image of your love, that by your Spirit, our way of life may become the way of Christ, through whom we pray. Amen.
The reading is from Luke, the 12th chapter, beginning with the 22nd verse. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, or about your body, what you will wear. For life is more than food, the body more than clothes. Consider the ravens. They do not sow or reap. They have no storeroom or barn. Yet God feeds them. And how much more valuable are you than birds? You who worry can't add a single hour to your life. Since you cannot do this little thing, why do you worry about the rest? Consider the wildflowers grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet, I tell you, not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow, thrown into the fire, how much more will he clothe you, you of little faith? And you do not set your heart on what will eat or drink. Do not worry about it, for the pagan world runs after such things, and your Father knows that you will need them. But seek his kingdom, and these things will be given to you as well. Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourself, provide purses for yourselves that will not wear out, a treasure in heaven that will never fail, where no thief comes near, no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will also be. This ends the reading.
Let us pray. Prepare our hearts, Lord, to receive your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, so that by hearing we may believe, and by believing we may obey your will, revealed to us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Mark Iaconelli was the son of one of my favorite writers, Mike Iaconelli, and Mark has picked up the mantle of his dad and is a beautiful writer. And he told the story about how he was sitting in church one day and he was going through the announcements and he saw this little blurb that said, they're looking for a volunteer who would help lead up a service for the college students. See, they were right across the street from Southern Oregon University and the 5,000 students going there, and they thought, ooh, wouldn't that be a great prime opportunity for our church to be able to reach out and have a service. And Mark had been a youth director, he had been a retreat leader, he had written 4 books on ministry, and so he went to the pastor and he said, you know, I really feel called to do this. And she said, oh, you know, that sounds like it would be great for you. So he started planning. It was 3 months before they were going to have their first service, but he immediately got down to it. Oh, he went and he scoured and got good liturgies. He went out and he bought lumber and he built this big, huge cross, wooden cross that was going to lay on the floor. And he went and scoured for river rocks and he bought tons and tons of candles because, you know, you got to have candles. And he was so excited. He went across the street to talk to the chaplain at the university. And then he put up signs all over and he talked to all the different groups. And there is going to be this really cool worship service. And he even came up with this really ambiguous name like Encounter. You know, what does that mean? Well, so he was so excited. He went out and he found 3 musicians and he hired them to play. And he even trained them in some of the Taze and the Iona community so they'd have very nice contemplative music. And so he was just excited about this. The night before, he couldn't sleep. all night long he kept thinking, oh, this is going to be so good and so cool. And people are going to just come and come and come. And, you know, we'll be that sanctuary for those lost and troubled college students. You know, we'll have Bible studies and theological discussions. You know, maybe even at spring break, we can take some of the core students down to Mexico. I mean, his mind was going a mile a minute, and he was dreaming and dreaming and dreaming. Oh yeah, they were even gonna have a free supper with this. Soup, of course, because that's good, warming. He had three of the women from church who were in their 70s, 80s, you know, and because they know how to make good soup. And so he was set. Morning came, he got to church 3 hours early because he's gonna make sure everything is perfect. He went into the sanctuary. He took out the first pew. He put the big cross down. He put the river rocks around. He even had these bowls filled with sand because they were going to light candles and stick the candles in the sand and for contemplative worship. Of course, they would even sit down and be able to have time with just the cross. The musicians were there. He helped the women make soup. It was coming along, and he was so excited. About 15 minutes before the service, he took some of the bulletins, and he went out, opened up the church door, and he waited. Almost immediately, he saw 15 students coming across the road, and he smiled warmly and good morning and good to see you. And they looked at him and smiled, even waved, hit that sidewalk, turned and went into the grocery store next door. He thought, okay, I'll be ready. More students crossing the street. And he'd smile at them and warmly greet them, and some of them would look at him, and some of them just kept walking. And it went on and on. About 5 minutes after worship was supposed to start, he walked back into the sanctuary, and there was the pastor and the musicians and then the three women who had made the soup. Not a single student. But he thought, okay, we'll have the service. So they started the service, and you know, it was beautiful. It was a beautiful service. And then they got to that part in the service where the students were going to come up, sit down on the floor, and light candles and consider the cross while they were singing contemplative songs. He didn't know what was going to happen. The three women in their 70s and 80s got up, walked towards the cross, and boy, do I understand this. They kind of looked at the floor, looked at each other, looked at the floor again, and finally, one woman grabbed her other friends and started going down. And she got down to a squat, and then like a deep sea diver, she let go and fell with a thump onto the carpet, but she was down. And she said, oh my! And Mark Iaconelli thought, oh Lord, what's happening? So then the next one comes. She's not going to do the deep sea diving way. Nope. She's going to get into the V. And she's going to reach down until her hands touch the floor. And then she would walk her hands down farther till they collapsed and she fell smack dab right on her face. Well, the last one standing is thinking, oh no, now what am I gonna do? And she went to run and help her friend, tripped over the candles and fell on top of her friend. Meanwhile, the pastor and the musicians and Mark were singing, stay with me, wait with me, stay with me. It was a service. Nobody got hurt. But Mark thought, oh no. But they were going to do this. They were going to keep doing this. So the next week, same eight people. The three musicians, the three women making soup, the pastor, and Mark. And they went through that for 7 months. Sometimes there would be more people. It actually grew to about anywhere between 15 and 30 people, you know, and it was, they finally thought, okay, let's take the cross up off the floor and put it on a table so people don't have to go falling in. But not one student. He said average age was about 60. But it was a nice service. And he thought, okay, a month before they were supposed to stop, he went to the pastor and he said, I feel like a failure. He said, I didn't do it. And she said, you know, I understand, and if you want to quit, you know, you can, but no, it's not a failure. But he felt like one. I mean, here was this big college service supposed to take place, and not a single college student walked through those doors. It was near about the last service before they were going to stop. And one of the musicians named Kim said, do you think I can talk with you? And he said, sure. She said, I heard you were gonna quit. And she said, I just want to let you know. She told him her story. And they talked about expectations, and they talked about disappointment. Because when you stop and think about disappointment, when you think about building your expectations, I mean, he was already taking mission trips with these people. But have you had those times in your life? Have you had those times in your life when what you want and what you expect, and it doesn't go that way at all? Mark Iaconelli said, I realize that's most of my life. My expectations don't match what my life is about. And I agree with him. I mean, I have my agendas, and God laughs. I know what I want to get done, and it usually doesn't happen. And no matter how careful the planning is, matter how much I've got it set, it doesn't often go that way. Our disappointments, and that can really bring you down, can't it? You plan for things so much. You have such hope in some people, and you're left disappointed. So where do you find grace in the midst of that? When Mark met with Kim, as they were talking, She told him her story about how, you know, she suffered through just a horrible childhood and young adulthood and filled with abuse and abandonment. And she said, I just want you to know I'm not a Christian, but I've watched you and I've heard you over this past year. And she said, and I realize that I want that. And she said, I don't know what you have to do to become a Christian. I don't know that road, but I'm wondering, can you be my sponsor? Mark said, today they still have that service. He said, the guitar player has gone through a terrible divorce, but has started coming to church and has gone on many of their retreats. And the violinist is a regular at their church service. And Kim, who came to talk to him, leads the music on Sundays. We don't always know what God has in mind. We don't always know how God can take what we think is a disappointment, what we think is a failure, and God can have something good come out of it. And that's tough for us, because we want to hold on to the control. We want to make sure we are in control. And God says, let it go. That's tough. But that's trust. And to be able to see that God is still working, even in the midst of our disappointments, in the midst of our failures, that God says, I will be with you. Is there grace in the midst? Yes. Sometimes we have to look hard. Sometimes we have to step out of our box. But know that God is there and working. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Please stand as you are able for the song, Let It Be. Thank you.
Let us pray. God, our Creator, when you speak, there is light and life. When you act, there is justice and love. Grant that your love may be present here today, so that what we say and what we do may be filled with your Holy Spirit. In the midst of our disappointments and seeming failures, help us to see beyond our short-sighted vision, to trust you to work through us. Help us to see your grace in the midst of our disappointments. Be with us as we pray together the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ Jesus dwells in our hearts through faith as we are being rooted and grounded in love, strengthened by the Spirit and filled with all the fullness of God. Amen. Our sending song is on another sheet in your bulletin there, and it is High Hopes. God blesses us and sends us in mission to the world. Thanks be to God.